Having spent a fascinating day learning about the formation and display of the peerless art collections of Charles I and Henrietta Maria, in this paper I'm going to turn to the next chapter in the story and address the consumption of the royal goods after the execution of the king in 1649. In particular, I'm going to focus on the retention, as opposed to the dispersal, of artwork by the state, and consider what this reveals about their priorities and artistic taste of the Lord Protector Oliver Cromwell. Many of you here will be well versed in what has been termed the Commonwealth Sale and the mass dispersal of much of the royal collection which followed it. But for those that aren't as familiar, I will just start by very briefly outlining the sequence of events for context. I seem to have lost the mouse. Here we go. Following the King's execution on the 30th of January 1649, the new government decided to liquidate the royal assets that had come into its possession, which included most of the palaces about the country and the goods within them, as well as liquidise other assets, notably gold, which was melted down to turn into coin. An act for the sale was passed on the 4th of July 1649, and a team of trustees was appointed to inventory and value the King's, Queen's and Prince's goods, plus a group of contractors was appointed to sell them from Somerset House. Portions of the proceeds of the sale were to go in the first instance to the Navy and to pay off the debts incurred by the King, Queen and Prince before the Civil Wars. Any money left after that was to be used as a council of state saw fit, and I quote, for public uses of this Commonwealth. The sale began in late October 1649, was mostly complete by 1651, and was officially closed in 1654, although secondary sales of royal goods on the open market continued in the years after that. And this is just a selection of a list of the early buyers. You can see one of the dates is 17th of October. And you can see at first they weren't for very large amounts. There's a £1.10. The largest on the page is John Bolton for £56. And this was followed by group purchases by syndicates of creditors. Okay. The official sale and ensuing sales on the open market notoriously resulted in many precious items being shipped out the country, in some cases by the cartload. Some of these were particularly prized masterpieces of Italian painting. Walking around the Charles I King and Collector exhibition, you will note some rather impressive foreign loans. For example, these works by Titian are now in the Louvre and the Prado collections. Other masterpieces, not shown in the exhibition but discussed in the catalogue, include more works by Titian, as well as by Correggio, Raphael and other artists. So these items are some of the ones that got away, so to speak, in the course of the 1650s, never to return other than on temporary loan. But what of the goods from the royal collection that didn't get away? In the time that is available today, I want to focus on the items from the collection of Charles I that were retained or bought back for the uses of the state and put at the disposal of the Lord Protector Cromwell at his principal, principal residences, the Palace of Whitehall in Westminster, and at his country weekend retreat, Hampton Court. Initially, it was agreed with the sale trustees that £10,000 worth of raw goods, about £1 million in today's money, were not to be released from sale, but instead retained by the Council of State representing the Commonwealth Government for its own use. This allowance was doubled to £20,000 in July 1651, but after Cromwell was made Lord Protector at the end of 1653, he reserved yet more goods for his own use, and we know this because there were several petitions complaining about this fact. Finally, in 1654, the sale shut down completely after the Protectorate refused to release the reserve goods for sale. The trustees were ordered to send everything outstanding to Clement Kinnisley, the chief wardrobe keeper, for Cromwell's use. From this point on, the Protectorate and Cromwell's servants put an enormous amount of effort into securing and relocating royal goods, in some cases repossessing items which had been loaned out or buying back items which had passed into private ownership. We have a good idea of which goods were kept by the state because the sale trustee's clerk, Thomas Beecham, produced an itemised list of all the goods that had been reserved for the use of the state and were awaiting parliamentary approval. He was ordered to do this in September 1651, but understandably, given the great number of items that had been reserved, It seems to have taken him a while to finish the list, as he signs off the final total on the 19th of July, 1654. And I've just included for you here on the left the 1651 order start date, and at the end his signature on the 19th of July, 1654. However, more additions to the list were apparently added after this date, as a further list of almost £1,900 worth of pictures and pedestals, you'll see, was scribbled on the back page. This brought the value of goods reserved up to £53,870, 2 shillings and 1 pence. This is not to say that the Protectorate actually managed to keep all these goods it had reserved. Some items were in fact double booked, due to their indecision at making their purchases. The trustees had actually sometimes, in some cases, sold them on. And they'd made it into the hands of creditors to the Crown. But the Protectorate probably kept a large proportion after closing the sale in 1654. So what did Council of State and the Lord Protector Cromwell keep back from the sale of Charles I's collection? And where was it displayed? Beecham's list shows that the goods retained or brought back by the state included many practical domestic items and furniture, as might be expected, given that they needed to furnish government offices and dwellings in the old royal palaces, and in quite enormous spaces, as well as fine plate, musical instruments, and even a globe of the world. Among these items were large amounts of luxury furnishings, as well as artwork. This suggests that the Council of State and Cromwell were well aware of the importance of material magnificence as a device for projecting political power and status, in much the same way as preceding monarchs had done. However, they had to achieve this with a fraction of the cost of the goods available to Charles I, indeed with his own goods. Clearly, Cromwell did not want to receive important guests, such as ambassadors, in palaces with denuded walls. So rich hangings and tapestries, mostly described as arras hangings, were the decoration of choice. With spacious rooms to adorn, tapestries may have offered more bang for your buck than other artworks, and as luxury items, they were impressive indicators of status of the owner. The royal collection had enormous amounts of these, of which many were retained or bought back by the state. The Protectorate's adoption of the established trappings of European rulers is reflected in contemporary reports that mention the interiors of the protectorial palaces, such as Whitehall, as very glorious and well furnished, with the banqueting house being hung with extraordinary rich hangings. The one on the left is a description of an ambassador's visit. We know Cromwell saw the value of tapestries, as it was he who requested in 1650 that 10 enormous pieces of tapestry depicting the victory by sea over the Spanish fleet of 1588, otherwise known as the Armada tapestries, were reserved for the state. The Armada tapestries had been displayed in the House of Lords at the Palace of Westminster sporadically on special occasions, really, from 1644, but it seems they were displayed permanently in the House of Lords by 1651. Beecham's list of reserve goods reveals that the other hangings assigned to the Protector were of dramatic, classical, mythological, and biblical scenes. These included series depicting the sieges of Jerusalem and Troy, the histories of Charlemagne and Julius Caesar, the judgment of Solomon, and a set showing the 7 deadly sins. The most expensive tapestry by far among those reserved was a 10-piece set once owned by Henry VIII depicting the history of Abraham, which was enriched with gold and silver thread and was valued accordingly at the enormous £8,260. This impressive array of tapestries was evidently considered not quite enough, however, and several more were bought back from sale purchases. For example, in the October of 1654, a 6-piece suite of The Story of Vulcan, Mars and Venus was bought for £350, which was hung in Cromwell's own lodgings at Whitehall. Furthermore, in late 1656, a selection of goods, including hangings, was ordered to be transferred from Scotland to London for the use of the Protector. In addition to the appropriation of royal tapestries, the tools for tapestry making were likewise reserved at the tapestry works at Mortlake, which had been a pet project of Charles I, along with the drafts of designs in the hands of the designer Francis Klein. From 1653, Cromwell issued a series of orders for new designs to be created so that new tapestries could be made of the Abraham series and also of Mantegna's famous 9 feet square tempera on canvas paintings of the triumph of Caesar. I might have to do a double click here. Which at £1,000 were the most expensive paintings in the reserved goods, although to put the relative value of painting and tapestry in perspective, the Abraham tapestries were valued at 8 times the value. It seems the Raphael cartoons of the Acts of the Apostles were also likely to have been retained with a view to being made into tapestries. Given that the cartoons had the impressive provenance of being commissioned by Pope Leo X as the designs for tapestries for the Sistine Chapel, the cartoons were perhaps a rather surprising popish choice for a so-called Puritan ruler. The series of orders for new tapestry designs demonstrate that Cromwell had the power to pick and choose which goods he wanted to retain, the luxury to change his mind about his selections, and even to order new artwork inspired by items from the royal collection and command creative direction over the use of the designs. However, the maximum cost cited in this final order, £150, was not a great amount of money for the making of tapestry, which is an indicator that the Protectorate was attempting to adopt the trappings of magnificence on a shoestring budget. Nevertheless, in continuing the works at Mortlake, Cromwell enabled the continuation of a type of artistic production that had been championed by Charles I. While Beauchamp's list is useful in itemising the goods reserved by the state, another source is invaluable in providing a glimpse of how a protectorial palace looked. This is an inventory of the goods at Hampton Court, drawn up after Cromwell's death in September 1658 and completed on the 18th of June 1659. It gives a valuable insight into what the Cromwell country residence looked like shortly after his death, and therefore gives an indication of how it might have looked the years previously. In the Long Gallery could be found the Triumphs of Caesar and one other unusual picture of an appropriate hunting theme, one picture of a large pair of horns was in the late Prince's Gallery, and Hampton Court was the country palace. It was known as a site of hunting, so hence that theme. However, other than these paintings and the Raphael cartoons, no other pictures are mentioned. Instead, the inventory reveals that the main spaces of the palace were richly adorned in arras tapestries, Turkey carpets, and luxurious fabrics. In a room appointed to strangers, that is for foreign visitors, the appraiser found the room hanged with 44 pairs of crimson velvet and gold cloth of gold, and one bedstead with a furniture of needlework of poetical fancies. The Protector was clearly keen to impress his guests with all the fine trimmings worthy of a head of state, and not, as we might assume, the sparse furnishings of an austere Puritan. The inventory is also helpful in providing entries that correspond with Beauchamp's list. Among many other tapestries, here we find in the dressing room of the late Queen, 3 pieces of fine tapestry hangings of Vulcan and Venus. And then, rather unexpectedly for a Puritan ruler, in Cromwell's own bedchamber, another 5 pieces of fine tapestry hangings of Vulcan and Venus. The Protector clearly liked this rather racy story, and it's quite interesting to compare with Karen's account of Charles I keeping a beautiful Van Dyck portrait of his wife in his bedchamber, and it's rather reverse of what you would expect, so we all know about the story of Vulcan, Mars and Venus. There are also several tapestries in the on the subject of triumphs. Plus, in the Paradise Room were 7 pieces of rich hangings of arras of the triumphs of the capital sins, presumably the tapestries of the seven deadly sins. So, expensive tapestries featuring a glory, triumphs, prophets, great rulers, and a few gods. It seemed that the Protectorate had no qualms about projecting courtly magnificence in its state buildings, as well as in the Protector's private lodgings. The Hampton Court inventory also includes fountains and antique sculpture in the gardens, such as the brass statues of Venus, Cleopatra, Adonis and Apollo that were located in the Moat Garden. We know more about the sculptures in the gardens at Whitehall and Hampton Court because of a petition to the Protector in 1658 from creditors asking for works they had bought in the sale, but that were already reserved by Cromwell, to be restored to them. And I quote, "they having been great sufferers by the late General Cromwell's detaining thereof." Among these were 2 sculptures allocated to the creditor Emmanuel de Critz, Antoninus for £120 and a Deianira for £200. I show one of them here. Cromwell's taste in the classical nude statues was not approved of by some, and it was reported that the statue of Antoninus and other statues were attacked by a fanatical Quaker, and the sculptures were criticised in a letter by a Puritan called Mrs. Mary Netherway, which I've detailed out here. She calls them monsters, and that they were very evil. Nevertheless, such garden decoration was to continental taste, and an ambassador speaks very positively about a walk in Hampton Court Gardens with the Lord Protector and his family. The Hampton Court inventory gives a wholesale picture of the distribution of royal goods in an ex-royal palace, yet notably doesn't feature many pictures. Most of these, therefore, must have been on display in Cromwell's weekly palace, Whitehall. Other than the cartoons, which were not on display, and the triumph canvases, which in many ways functioned as tapestries, albeit not very warm, only 9 other pictures were included in the main body of Beauchamp's list, so I mean not the little last, the additional section on the end. These were a picture of Edward III in the Garter Room at Windsor, valued at £4, a picture of the four elements at Somerset House, valued at £15, so not great amounts, and specifically stated to be in Cromwell's use at Whitehall, 3 paintings by Giulio Romano, The Burning of Rome by Nero, £25, Julius Caesar with an eagle above his shoulders, £34, Temperance putting water in a glass, £15, and also at Whitehall, the Protector, were 3 landscapes and a pastoral scene of a shepherd and a nymph. Yet, to this lineup, we can also add those 24 pictures itemised at the end of Beauchamp's list. Perhaps the reserve pictures were harder for Beauchamp to track down, because Jan van Belkamp, the successor to Abraham van der Doort as a keeper of the king's pictures, and probably the main trustee responsible for drawing up the inventories of works of art, had died by this date. There isn't time today to go through all the 24 pictures in the scribbled list in great detail, but I will pick out a few for comment. The pictures are, in general, of modest price, mostly valued at under £40, but ranging in price from £2 for a landscape by a Fletcher, whom I believe to be the painter Tobias Flossius, to the most expensive painting, Titian's Herodias with the head of St. John the Baptist, sort of otherwise also known as Salome, different person, but same sort of topic, which had been valued at £150. There is also a picture attributed to Schiavone for £100 and one attributed to Pordenone for £80. You'll note there are lots of attributions at the time that we have now disagreed with, but the point still stands that they thought they were by those artists. These were still very small amounts in comparison to the thousands of pounds afforded on decking out the palaces with sumptuous tapestries and velvet and damask furniture. However, while distinctly no blockbusters, the list does suggest that the state had a mind to selecting pictures with artistic merit and artists who had remained fashionable since the 1630s. Therefore, we find 2 works attributed to Titian, 1 each attributed to Pordenone and Schiavone, and 3 pictures described as being by Giulio Romano, as well as portraits by Van Sommer and Geertz and other artists that you'd find in other courtly collections. There is a portrait of a court jester, John Derry, possibly selected for its merit as a painting by Geertz. Another slightly unusual selection include a picture of a German stag. Could this be a copy of a stag in the Royal Collection reported by Virtue as being by Jan van Belkamp? Another picture listed is a picture of a giant, about which I know nothing. Other subjects are, however, along more conventional lines for the period, such as the Arcadian scene and the landscapes, of which one was particularly good, painted by Jan Porcellis. There was also a selection of portraits, no recent royal ones for obvious reasons, but apparently very old portraits of English royals was entirely acceptable, such as the one of Edward III. Furthermore, the 3 portraits of the King and Queen of France and a French ambassador indicates a nod to diplomacy. And here I just show a selection of them for you. I should also mention at this point, although I'm not going to go into it in detail, but we also know Cromwell commissioned portraits of himself and his family and used the services of leading contemporary portrait painters at the time, before the sale as well, so by Sir Peter Lely, Samuel Cooper, Robert Walker, and so on. And this is alongside the reserved goods retained from the state. Some reserve pictures were, however, somewhat counterintuitive choices from a government which explicitly banned the consumption of popish or lascivious pictures. For example, this picture on the right of a rather buxom woman, so-called Temperance, seems rather more salacious than its title would lead you to believe. Perhaps they selected it without actually having looked at the work, or maybe they didn't mind. Titian's Salome, now Salome, not Herodias, with the head of John the Baptist, was perhaps a little too close to home given the recent beheading of the last head of state. And indeed, it appears that this work was at some point released for sale or rejected as it had ended up in the Prado. So question mark above that one. Two other paintings were also rather political in theme. These were a picture once thought to be a dictator, or Julius Caesar, a character whom by now you would have grasped was a particular favourite of Cromwell. We now know the painting was in fact of Emperor Claudius, but the imperial and martial topic still stands. Another work along these lines, but rather with even more dark overtones, was The Burning of Rome by Nero, also now known as Nero Playing While Rome Burns. A cheery topic to hang in the council chamber. Three religious works were also surprisingly included on the list. Two can't be traced, and the one that remains, The Assumption of the Virgin, lost the offending section with the ascending virgin, so it's sort of cut in half, at some point in the sort of second half of the 17th century, I think, so possibly during the 1650s, which begs the question, if these items were intended to be chopped about and defaced, why reserve them in the first place? Why use up your allocated amount of money? Or perhaps did you not mind them? And maybe it was chopped up at a later date. Another religious topic, a picture of the Christ child with St. John the Baptist, was described as the two boys in the list of reserved goods, presumably to conceal its slightly superstitious content. And I just want to make a comparison here. So in a striking example of two people of very different religious and political leanings collecting similar types of art, this was the exact description, the two boys I mean, given to another portrait of the same subject by Van Dyck, acquired in 1655 by Sir Justinian Isham, a high Anglican royalist in exile on his estate in Northamptonshire, Lamphill Hall, of which there is a version in the royal collection. So in conclusion, although we cannot be entirely certain as to the rationale of collecting, from surviving records, it is possible to glean some idea of the sort of artwork Cromwell inherited from Parliament's reserved goods, which items he specifically coveted, and to some extent, how he furnished his private residences during his protectorate. The exhibition curators Per Rumberg and Desmond Shaw Taylor state perceptively in the catalogue and in the exhibition that all collections are formed by an interaction of opportunity, fashion, and personal taste. In the case of the Commonwealth government, the opportunity came from the execution of the king and the passing of the seized collections into the state's hands for disposal as they saw fit. Though limits were put upon the Council of State's reservations, these were not ceded to, and the Protectorate apparently reserved all the goods it wanted, creating a collection within a collection. In terms of fashion, although the most fashionable works were released for sale overseas, it seems that attempts were made to retain artwork along roughly established modes of courtly display, with an emphasis on expensive luxury hangings, antique sculpture, and Italian history paintings, as well as portraits and landscapes. This suggests that the Protector recognised the importance of magnificence as a political tool for asserting authority, and was conscious of the role of the visual arts in the projection of this power. Cromwell then not only absorbed some of the most famed items from the collection of Charles I, by which I mean the cartoons and the Mantegna and the lots of tapestries, but sought to augment his collection among similar lines of the royals who had preceded him, and was at several instances directly involved in the shaping of this display. And finally, in regard to Cromwell's taste, the evidence indicates that the Protector favoured sumptuous hangings, costly interiors, and antique sculpture over an extensive display of pictures, as preferred by Charles I. However, his taste in pictures still comes through in his preference for martial and imperial subjects of the lives and triumphs of great classical generals and emperors, thus aligning himself with ancient classical precedent rather than recent kingly example. Yet the subjects of some of his selection from Charles I's picture collection, not to mention nude statues, indicate a surprising tolerance or even enthusiasm for more superstitious and lascivious content than one might expect. And in this way, his picture selection is not dissimilar from those of his political and religious rivals. Thank you.